Exploring your digital maquettes and showing each structural element and then grouping it together again is a really cool way to win a client. You are literally showing your project in a better way. But you know what's cooler? Knowing that I don't have to spend hours doing this and just do it really quick using D5Render. So let me show you how. Okay, so let me show you the project that I'm gonna be working with. It's a small cabin that I had already shown in the channel, and I made videos about collage illustration, a day render, and even a portfolio spread. But I think creating a digital maquette to show the context, terrain, and how the building is built is always necessary. So this is the 3D model of the cabin. As you can see, it's a very basic model that has a terrain. For this project, I'm going to delete it. It also has a basic structure applied, and overall, it looks kind of interesting. And as always, for my reference images, I know I want to create a maquette image that is a mix of these images that you see right here. This, for one, has an exploded feel to it, where we can see the inside of the project and the main architectural spaces. Now, this other one is mostly a good reference of the terrain, which makes it look more like a hand model than a 3D model. And finally, this other one has a specific type of lighting, which I like, which is one main light source coming from above and probably a secondary light source from the opposite side. Now for the materials in all of these, you can see that the wood grain material has to be that of a maquette. And in some maquettes, we find different types of woods to create a contrast in between materials. Now to prepare our model for D5Render and more for our phasing animation, it's really important that we make sure of two different things. First, that all of our elements are placed into groups, so we shouldn't leave any element that we want to animate outside of a group. And second, each group shouldn't have more than two layers of depth. This is because D5Render can recognize two group structures, but not more than two. So for example, for this roof structure, which is all placed into one whole group, and if I go inside, I have a group for the wood structure, the general sheets, and the perimeter bracing, and inside my wood structure, I have a group for each side, and within these groups, I have a group for the vertical elements and the horizontal ones. But I want to animate each one of these elements, so I have to separate them completely from these groups. So I'll go into each group, hit Control X, and exit the groups, and then paste it into place like this. And I'm going to repeat this same process for all of the elements that I want to animate. Now, I erased my original terrain because I wanted to have a more maquette style terrain. So one that looks more or less like this. So for this, I'll create a rectangle around my cabin, extrude it, then duplicate my form. I'll go onto the top view and draw a curve that indicates the level of the terrain. So obviously some of you may have these curves already drawn, so you just use them instead. But from this terrain, I only know that the difference between this level and the top part is around 3 meters. And this is how the terrain looks like after doing this. I'll group all of this into one layer and also make sure my context houses are also here. Now, before we go on to D5, I want to make sure the materials are applied all in a different way. Here, you can just differentiate these with colors. So in D5, it's recognized as a different material. It's gonna be easier in D5. So this is the specific workflow for SketchUp, but if you want to find out how to do this with Rhino or with Revit, you can go to the D5 YouTube channel and they have a video specifically about this. Now for only the elements that I'm going to animate, which is basically my cabin, I'm going to select all of them, click on the export button, click on selected only, and for structure info, I want to make sure it's in two layers. Now make sure you have the latest version of D5 LiveSync to do this, and have this option. And since I know that I'm going to import my cabin later on, I'll just turn off my cabin in my original layer. Now I'm going to click on connect to D5Render and open my model. I'll synchronize it to a new project. And after D5 opens, I'll unlock my model and elevate it slightly just above the terrain. Next, I'm going to go to import, select my cabin, and import it. And now I'm going to align it with my terrain. If this needs to be more precise, you can go back to the SketchUp model, turn on the cabin, click on sync once, and go back to D5 and align it properly with the base cabin. Now you can go back to SketchUp and turn it off just in case. So since I need the scale of this to be similar to a hand model and apply a light that simulates the same scale, I need to shrink my model and my terrain. If I didn't shrink it and used it as it is, the lights that I would apply would not be big enough to feel like artificial lights and would complicate things more or less. So for this, I'll group both layers, make sure they are unlocked, of course, and scale them down. I usually just erase one number from the end and that's it. Now I'll drag all of my model down and close to the ground. Now I'll go to Model Basics and add a white plane model as the base of my maquette. And then I'm gonna duplicate this plane, rotate it, so that can serve as a backdrop for my image. So overall, it should look something like this. Now, let's go to materials. Let's search for light concrete and apply it to the plane. So here we just want a subtle texture, nothing too strong or too contrasty. Now let's go to the environment and turn down the sun direction until everything gets really, really dark. So around 12 p.m. is perfect. And next, let's go to our light panel and select rectangular light and place it. Then elevate it just a bit, rotate it, and direct it towards the cabin. And now I'll adjust the intensity to about 40, but you can see which one adjusts best to your model, and the attenuation radius to about 12,000. I'll make sure the visible in reflection is turned off as well, so we don't have any strong reflections on our model. And here I always prefer to turn off the auto exposure, you know, so D5 render doesn't always correct the exposure and I can never see how dark or how bright everything is. It's just always like in a mid-tone sort of way. So if I turn it off, you can see the real values of the lights. And if I duplicate this light with Control D and place it on the opposite side, here I can lower the intensity. I just want a small side light to my image, like a small rim light. Now I'll start applying a wood material to the model. So I'll go to the material tab. I'll select this wood right here, but you can select the one you like or another material altogether. And to increase the realism, I'll go to the properties of the material and adjust the UV mapping to make the map bigger and make it seem like a hand model. This is a really important part. So something around 0.5 or 0.05 or 0.08 seems to do the job just right for me. Now make sure to also adjust the mapping of the wood and the direction. So you can see the direction of the wood grains is in the best direction possible. Now I'll apply the same material to my whole model, except for the glass, of course. I'll also apply this material to the terrain, with the only difference is that when I go to the material settings from the terrain, I will also go to the base color map option, which is this one right here, and increase the light ever so slightly, so it looks a little bit lighter than the cabin. This will give it just a nice contrast of the model with the terrain. I'll apply another wood material to my context buildings and adjust the mapping as well. Now I'll create a scene of my main view, adjust the view, and here I want the field of view to be very, very low, so it's more like an orthographic kind of image, and turn on the depth of field to increase the blurriness. This will give it that small scale effect. And obviously, if your computer is slow or your project is much bigger than this one, you can leave this step for last to save some precious memory on your computer. Now let's add the maquette style trees and characters to our model. So I'll go to Assets, Models, and Stylized, and select the type of tree I like. In this case, I like this one. I'll add it to my model, scale it down, and duplicate it sometimes with Control D around the maquette. And now I'll repeat the same process with a second type of tree, and then with a third type of tree. The more variation, the better. Now I'll place some characters in the middle of my scene, and that's it. Now in the layer panel, I'll select all of the trees right here and change the material on this right side to a wood grain material. Then before we go onto our animation, I'll add a point light inside our cabins. I'll go to the point light panel, which is this one right here, add a point light and place it in the interior, in the inside of my cabin. And here I can adjust the size and the height, but most importantly here, I just want to adjust the temperature and make sure the temperature of the light is very warm. And this will create a nice contrast of these two types of lights, like the cold light and the warm light. So as you can see, we have a nice maquette image, but now I want to explode it and see each element inside of my design. So I would like to create an animation that shows the project for a second, opens it up, and we can see each element that's inside and then closes it back again. If it helps, you can sketch this out in a short storyboard kind of way so you can get an idea of what you're going to animate. This just makes the whole process much easier. But now I'll go to video and make sure my timeline option option is turned on. Now in the latest version of D5, you should see a tab that says templates. And here I'll select the explode template and then select my first four roof coverings. So since I know that I separated these elements into individual groups, I can just select them and they will be added. Now, if you probably clicked on one by mistake, just go to this layer tab and erase it from the list. Now I want the simultaneous option to be on, and I want the roof coverings to explode only about 80 centimeters away from their original place. And I also want to make sure they are visible at the start and at the end as well. So if I go to my timeline and press play, you can see how it looks, which, you know, I like it. What do you think? Now here I want to explode the roof cover, expose the roof structure, elevate it, and see the inside of the cabin. So what I need to do next is make sure my roof structure rises. So I'll go to template, I'll select rise, select my roof structure, and add it to the group. Now for the time interval, I'll lower it a bit just so each element moves independently in their own kind of way. And for the distance, I'll place it at around 50 centimeters. I'll repeat this same thing, but with another element of the roof structure, which is this one right here. And the only difference here is that I want my distance to be shorter so you can see the exploded part, and you can see one element right here and another one at the bottom. And after I applied my animation and I press play, it should look something like this. Pretty cool, right? And I'll start creating the animations to revert this. Ideally, I could select all these animations and just click on invert or reverse, but maybe this can be a feature that we can see later on in D5. I don't know, let me know. So I'll go to template, click on drop instead of rise, and select the roof structure elements, just like we did before. And here I want to make sure the drop distance is exactly the same as the rise distance, so our animation doesn't look choppy afterwards. So if you had 50 centimeters, it has to be the drop distance from the 50 centimeters as well. Now I'll repeat the same process with my other structural elements. And finally, for the roof coverings, of course, I'll select the implode template. For each effect, there's an opposite effect. So for the drop, there's a rise. For an explode, there's an implode. So for there's a fly in, there's a fly out. So they always have both kinds of effects to make it easier for you. So I'll select the implode template and select my roof elements and adjust the distance. And after I have all of my animations set, I'll click on play and it should look something like this. Now this is looking really, really cool. But before I continue, I need to create a shot of this view. So here I'm going to create a shot of this view, and here I'm going to switch the timeline view so we can see this sort of timeline. And here I'll go to the start of my animation, just right here, and make sure my view is the same one I had my scene selected in, which should be this one right here. If I just click on it, it should go automatically to it. Now I'll add a second shot, so I'll go a little bit forward, add a second shot, and just zoom out just a bit, or maybe scroll out with your mouse, and update the shot right here so the settings are saved. Now I'll add a third shot with the same settings, and finally a fourth shot where I zoom in again, and obviously I update this scene. Now I'll switch my timeline view again so I can see my effects. And first I'll drag my first exploded animation layers to align with the moment that my camera backs away. So I have the camera still, and as soon as the camera backs away, the effects start, right? The exploding effects start. So then I'll align my second group of layers, which is where we have the implode version, to align with the moment my camera closes in on the subject again. So as soon as we close the building, the camera gets close to the building again. So it should look something like this when you press play. Nice. And you can get creative here with your shots, but this one is really simple and straightforward, but your creativity is the limit, of course. And as soon as I have my animation ready, I can just go to the clip and click on render. I want to export it in a 2K resolution at 30 frames per second. So this is the cool thing about D5, is that this step is usually pretty quick for such a complex animation. And this is the final result of the animation. I really like how it looks. And the cool thing is I can always go back to my timeline, erase the shots, and show the same animation from a different point of view. And after this, I also rendered individual images by just going to the image tab and clicking on render. And after these renders are done, I can use the AI enhancer built into D5 to slightly enhance my render. And I just have to double click on the render right here, select AI enhancer, And here, just adjust the slider. I usually set it to normal, nothing too strong. And then I'm gonna click on AI Enhancer and wait just a few seconds. And you can also have some fun by going into AI Style Transfer, selecting a style and adjusting it. And this is the result of some of these tweaks. I can also adjust the sharpening, the denoising, and if I want, I can just save the image again. So obviously this is a pretty cool feature. We would normally have to use another AI tool outside of D5 Render to create maybe different variations, different enhancements, but all of this you can do it now within D5 Render in the post AI processing tool, which is pretty cool. And these are the results of the images. And these are the results of the video. And these are some of the results I did after with the same techniques. What do you think? Now you can create the same model just by downloading D5 Render from the description. And I want to thank D5 Render for sponsoring this video and making this creation possible. If you want to see more D5 tutorials, comment down below. What type of tutorial would you like to see with D5? And if you want to see a D5 introduction for beginners, you can click on this video right here and learn all about it. That's all for this video. I'll see you in the next one.